Good morning. More than three quarters of a century ago, the Allied forces landed on the beaches of Normandy, France. In one of history's bloodiest battles, young men sacrificed life and limb to puncture and penetrate the great Nazi domination of Europe. As the blood flowed and soaked the beaches of Omaha and Utah, among others, a line was drawn in the sand that forever changed history. General Dwight Eisenhower commissioned his troops in part with this charge: "You will bring about the destruction of the German war machine, the elimination of Nazi tyranny over the oppressed peoples of Europe, and security for ourselves in a free world." Each year, this anniversary is commemorated with military honors to those who served, recollections of the terrible price, and charges to never forget June 6, 1944, known as D-Day. Similarly, nearly two millennia ago, another line was drawn in the dirt of a hill outside Jerusalem. An itinerant Jewish preacher stretched out his life and limbs to puncture and penetrate the gates of death and hell. As blood flowed from his hands, head, feet, and side, this God-man, who many already believed was Jesus the Christ, forever changed history. Luke records in this gospel that after taking the cup and the bread, Jesus commissioned his disciples to do this in remembrance of me. Later, Luke described how the early church gathered weekly on the first day of the week, or Sunday, to commemorate Christ's death and resurrection in Acts 27. Since the first century, the Church of Christ has paused as part of its worship to consume the bread representing Christ's body and drink the cup symbolizing his blood. This is a solemn occasion and as sacred as any honorable memorial for man. As we gather today, joining with millions of Christians from around the globe in remembrance, reflection, and repentance, let us also recall the additional charge by General Eisenhower to his D-Day troops. The free men of the world are marching together in victory. I have full confidence in your courage, devotion to duty, and skill in battle. We will accept nothing less than full victory. No doubt the coming days will prove an epic battle against the enemy. The combat will be personal and painful, and for some will include persecution. And yet Christians possess full confidence that no weapon formed against us will prosper. No power or principality can separate our communion with God. And ultimately, we are more than conquerors through Jesus Christ. So as we share in this memorial of sacrifice, let us look now forward without fear, dedicated to our sacred duties and willing to accept nothing less than full victory for the kingdom. For in reality, every Sunday is D-Day. We invite all those who are Christians to participate with us. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we come before you today asking for the forgiveness of our sins and that what the communion we are about to take will honor and glorify you. In your name we ask this. Amen.
Our very own Mr. Roger Gibson will be having a special for us.
How do you follow that?
Easy.
That was good. That was good. You know, hang on a second. You know, we all get down and out sometimes. Some of us more than others. But all we have to do is when we're at our lowest is to look to our Father and our Savior, and He will raise us up. Now, if I can talk, song I'd like to do is You Raise Me Up.
Down and oh, my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burdened be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until You come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on Your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. No life, no life without its hunger. Each restless heart beats so imperfectly. But when You come and I am filled with wonder, sometimes I think I glimpse eternity. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on Your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on Your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on Your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. Raise me up to more.
Well, good morning. All right, before anyone says something, because I know there's probably at least five or six of you that are ready to say something as soon as you walk out the door, I am aware that the song in the bulletin does not match the one we sang this morning. See? There's several of you like, It's because I forgot to give it to Amber. So that's 100% on me. Surprise. I am aware it was my mistake. I'll have it fixed for next time. But I'm glad to see everybody here for a couple of reasons. First and foremost, you need to know who we are, right? I've been talking about this on Sundays. It's kind of be one of those things I'm going to continue to do. Here at Canton Christian Church, we believe that it is all about Jesus all of the time. This isn't just something that we say. The idea of Jesus being at the center of everything we do is what this church was founded on. And it's going to be the belief that carries this church into the generations that come after us. And, you know, I'm excited to share a message with you. It's going to be our first week in a series here through the book of Romans. It's just called The Power of the Gospel. And I'm glad that you decided to come and worship with us here this morning, or those who are joining us online as you do every single week. We're glad that you're here, and we do not take that lightly. You could be almost anywhere to worship, but you chose to be here with us this morning, so we're glad to see you. And second, I am excited about this series. I love the book of Romans. If you haven't spent any time in it, I would highly encourage you to do so. Spend some time in the book of Romans digging in to what Paul has to say to the church there in Rome. I promise you there's some great things in there. We're going to highlight some things, and we're going to really expound on some stuff, and hopefully it's going to be great. So the whole premise of this series is that God has made himself known to all of humankind so that no one is without an excuse. No one has an excuse. Rather than choosing to worship and glorify him, we've chosen lesser gods in society. Gods like money, fame, success, substance. The list can go on and on and on. But this is the problem of sin, and it results in our disconnection from God. Right? We cannot save ourselves from this fallen state. We need a Savior, which is the power of the gospel. So before we go any further, let's open up with a word of prayer. Lord, this morning I pray that you give us the courage to take a stand against sin in our lives. Not just the sin in our world, the sin in other people's lives, but God, take a stand against the sin in our own lives. God, we thank you for sending Jesus to the cross, God, and thank you that we can rest in him and his power in our battle against sin and temptation. We do not have to try and fight this alone. God, you are willing to battle with us, and we cannot thank you enough for that. So God, I pray that every ear here is made ready to hear, every mind made ready to understand, and every heart made ready to accept your message for us today. God, we thank you. We love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So the first step to reconciliation with God is admitting that we are sinners. Right? We can think back to moments in our past, both distant and recent, where we have fallen short of God's glory. This is crucial to understanding God's love for us. Along with seeing our sin, we have to feel its weight. We have to know the cost. This will allow us to understand the true magnitude of Christ's sacrifice on the cross. Right? So we invite God to point out the areas in our lives that are still prone to sin. Like, what attracts us to sin? Right? Do you see the way out God provides you with? It's difficult to invite God into our lives, especially those parts where sin is rampant. We definitely don't want to ask God to point out those places in our lives. Like David says, God, if there's anything in me that offends you, point it out. Anybody ever prayed that prayer? And then God did so, and it was uncomfortable. So we don't like to do that. But it's important that we do. We invite God in. It's not to make us feel less. It's not to make us feel ashamed. It's so that we can begin the process of reconciliation with God. If you're not familiar with the book of Romans, it is the most systematic and developed doctrinal book of the Apostle Paul. Right, the probable date for the authorship of Romans is somewhere between 56 and 58 AD, which is within 24 to 26 years of Jesus' death. So Romans was likely written at Corinth toward the end of Paul's third missionary journey, just before he left for Jerusalem. Now, these are important. So one of the things that we kind of understand is the closer that something is written to an event, the more accurate it is, right? Can we all agree? Or at least we hope the more accurate it is. But the more time we give in between an incident and when we record it, things can come a little fuzzy, details aren't as sharp. So what we see here is this doctrinal book and this systematic walk Paul has is very closely related to the death of Christ and his ministry here on earth. So there's a lot of real hard-hitting things here that are coming directly from Paul's experience and his revelation from Jesus on the road to Damascus, his time spent in ministry. So this book is full of principles about living our life in response to the grace and mercy of God given through his son Jesus. Specifically, we will spend the next 5 weeks learning about the principles from Romans. So if you're a note taker, here's your first opportunity. So the principles for Romans we're going to look at, number one, the problem of sin. That's this week. Next week, we're going to look at the rescue from sin. Then in week three, we're going to look at the pursuit of righteousness. Week four, we're going to look at God chooses us. And in week five, we're going to look at the idea of a living sacrifice. We're going to leave this up for a little bit so that if you're taking notes, you can find those. If you're watching online, hopefully our picture-in-picture thing is working and you're seeing that in the bottom left-hand corner. So as I mentioned before, these are core principles of our faith and worthy of our study and our attention. So Paul is passionate about the power of the gospel. And at the very beginning of the book, this is what Paul has to say in Romans chapter 1, verse 16. He says, I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first for the Jew, then the Gentile. See, Paul knew, as we do now, that the gospel was meant for everyone. It was meant for the Jew, the Gentile, male, female, slave, and free. We see Paul dealing with these things through his other letters to the church, right? With the gospel, there is no partiality to the grace of the gospel. And thank goodness for that. There's no rhyme or reason that you have to do, things you have to complete, things you have to give, or whatever it may be, so that you can earn your way up into God's grace. The gospel is for everyone. It's the grace of God. It does not discriminate. The gospel does not pick favorites. The thing with sin is sin affects everyone. So the gospel is for everyone. Because the gospel is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone. So to understand God's grace, you must also understand sin. If you've got your Bible or the Bible app with you today, turn with me. Our main text is going to be Romans chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. And here's what Paul has to say. Verse 18, the wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Since what may be known about God is plain to them because God has made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him. But their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like a mortal human being and birds and animals and reptiles. Therefore, God gave them over in the sinful desires of their hearts to sexual impurity for the degrading of their bodies and one another. They exchanged the truth about God for a lie, worshipped and served created things rather than the Creator, who is forever praised. Amen. So this is an incredible passage from Paul. He just got done encouraging people and talking about God's good news, but now he has shifted to speak about a subject we don't often like to hear about: sin. Now, we talk about it all the time in church, but how many times can you remember where you spent time intentionally talking about sin? It doesn't happen very often. Sin is something we are all affected by. No one escapes it. We all understand that we all fall short of the glory of God. It's kind of one of those churchy Christian things that we say and then we move on. But it's one of those things we say and then we need to pause. We need to spend time there. We need to marinate and understand what that means. So back in the very first book of the Bible, right, Genesis, God created man and woman. God gave them free reign over almost all of the garden where they lived, with only one restriction: don't eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. One rule. I always joke, everybody talks about, you know, the people that they would talk to when they got to heaven. You know, the first person I'm going to go talk to is Adam. And Eve, like, really? One rule. That's it. Just one rule. We laugh, we chuckle, we smile. But how guilty of you, or are you, of breaking that one simple rule that you had as a kid or an adult? Here's one that almost everyone's guilty except for farmers. And some of them already know where I'm going. There's these things posted on the right-hand side of the road as you're driving down. They've got numbers on them. It's a speed limit. Farmers like to drive under them, so you guys are free. You're good here. The rest of us, those are usually a suggestion, kind of a roundabout speed to take. Okay, none of our deputies are here this morning, so I can say that. So I want you to be honest. Who here sometimes maybe goes a little faster than what's posted? You had one simple rule: follow the posted speed limit. How hard is that? It's really easy, especially if you have cruise control. You just push a button, set it, and go. But we get impatient. I want to get to point B. I'm tired of being in this car. These people, they drive me nuts. We need to get there. We make all the excuses in the world for breaking one simple rule. So before we look down our noses at Adam and Eve for breaking their one simple rule, you sin just as much, if not more. But even though the rule was in place for Adam and Eve, right, they broke it because the first man and woman both sinned against God by disobeying his command. Each man and woman after them have been impacted by the consequences of the original sin. Sin entered our world in that moment. It's never been the same since. It's been broken and faulty. So this is the reality that we're living in. Paul is writing that all have sinned. No one escapes that except for Jesus, of course. But that's what's crazy. Even amidst our sin, God has still revealed himself to us. Paul talks about this in verses 19 and 20 of the passage that I just read. No one has any excuse for not knowing God because of the ways he has revealed his invisible qualities through the visible ways and means. Even though God has revealed himself, many in our world don't want anything to do with him. Many are still blind to him through a willingness. It amazes me that toward the end of Jesus' life here on earth, he was brutalized and even eventually put on a cross to die for sinners like you and me. All the while, God, who is all-knowing, knew that there would be people who saw God, saw who he was, knew about his sacrificial love, and still turned their back and walked away from him, and yet he still covered them with the cross. Maybe some of us in this room and those who are watching online have experienced this as well. We have friends or family members in our lives who we've tried desperately to talk about Jesus with, We try to bring up Bible verses every time we see them and an opportunity arises. We pray for them constantly, and yet they still don't want anything to do with him. Verses 24 and 25, Paul says that God gave people over to their desires of their heart, not to the lack of effort on your part. They traded the truth of God for a lie. They traded the invisible power of the divine creator for powerless images and idols, created things for the creator of all things. Now, I'm not saying that you stop praying for that friend or family member. Please continue to do so. Every single day, pray for them. Every chance you get. Because one day, there may be an opportunity for them to soften their hearts and open their ears to hear the word of God. And we all know how that works. God gets a hold of us and does great things. I have that one in my life that I prayed for probably over 10 years on a regular basis. He finally came to his faith. He's serving in his church. He's leading his family well. There are times where I thought my prayers were just empty. Like, I know God can hear it, and maybe God's response is just not this one. Obviously, that's not God's response. Right? That was my frustration and that individual's lack of response. Because God's response is he wants everyone to know him. Every single person to know him and come to faith in him. Our hopes is that eventually they will respond. So this is the same trade-off many of us struggle with today. When we willingly give ourselves into the hands of powerless idols, we unknowingly give the devil opportunity to steal, kill, and destroy what's good in our lives. Interestingly, Paul actually instructs us not to allow the devil to even get a foothold in our lives. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 27, Paul says, "And do not give the devil a foothold." Now, if you look at the Greek and you start doing those word studies and those really nerdy things, do you know what this verse means? Just what it says. Do not give the devil a foothold. Don't give him any ground in your life, not even a place to rest his foot. Nothing. Give him no ground. Not a single inch. Now, the original word translated here as foothold is the Greek word topos. And this is what topos means: a place, ground, or opportunity. So this is what you don't give the devil in your life. You don't give him a place. Nothing. No spot in your mind or your heart where he has a place to reside. Then you do not give him any ground. Nothing. Nowhere to stand. The last one's hard, though, isn't it? Opportunity. You don't give the devil an opportunity in your life. Where do those opportunities come from? Sin. That sin in your life. So, this word topos, it's frequently used to describe an actual place in the New Testament where people arrive at or something is happening. Another way to think of this idea would be to use it in real estate terms. So those who have been in real estate, or if you've ever bought a house or anything like that, you know that buying and selling is all about what? Location, location, location. This is exactly what the devil's looking for in our lives. He's prowling around, biding his time, patiently waiting on an opportunity to take up residence in our lives by getting a place, a foothold, or that opportunity. In the Genesis account with Adam and Eve, where they sinned against God, the devil had taken up space in the garden. Right? He then used this space to whisper lies in the ears about who God was and what he had actually said to them. And for thousands of years, the devil's strategy has not changed. He's looking for a similar opportunity in your life. You are not exempt. You cannot hide from him. He knows where you're at. He knows where your struggles are. He's after your location, upon which he will build a case against the truth of the Creator. He begins to whisper lies, things like, could God really love you because he knows you did this? You said that. You thought this. Right, this is one of the main problems of sin. Our sin alienates us from God and gives the devil opportunity in our lives. Right, sin creates this chasm between us and God. And when we worship idols, we worship things, when we harbor things like unforgiveness, When we lie, cheat, steal our way to success, we're making room for the devil in our hearts. When we willingly give ourselves to sin, it's as if we open the door to our lives and shout, "Hey, devil, come on in. You've got room here." It's this invitation is obviously going to end poorly. It's not going to end well for us. It's not one that you are going to want to willingly extend. That's what it is, though. Sin is an extension. You're inviting him in. Instead, the Apostle Paul reminds us later in Ephesians chapter 6 about standing our ground and wearing the armor of God. You see what he says in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 12. "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, and against powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. So be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power." That's where our strength comes from. It's not you. You don't have the strength to fight this on your own. You'll fail miserably. Be strong in him, his power. And put on the armor of God so that you can take a stand against the devil's schemes, because that's all they are. They're schemes. Right? We must recognize the devil has evil plans for our lives. He wants to distract you and take you away. He wants to steal, kill, and destroy any and every godly thing you might have. So we must learn to stand our ground while pressing into God and his mighty power. We cannot give the devil a foothold. You cannot give him a place or an opportunity or a location in your life. Thankfully, God knew we couldn't win the fight of sin on our own. We couldn't muster up an army big enough or build a missile strong enough to win this cosmic battle for salvation. We needed a Savior to fight on our behalf. We needed Jesus. We needed Jesus to come and conquer sin and death. If one of the main problems of sin is that it alienates and separates us from God, then it stands to reason that one of the solutions to our problem is to be reconciled, redeemed, and put back in right relationship with God. We needed to be rescued from sin. Paul tells us in Romans chapter 3 that we have all fallen short of the glory of God in our lives. There isn't a person alive today who has not sinned, no matter how righteous they may seem or say they are. The scary part is that in our sin and in our willful disobedience, we open the door to the enemy. We make it easy for him. Genesis chapter 4, verse 7. "If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must rule over it." Sin is always crouching at our door, waiting for us, ready to pounce. Sin desires us to have you, right? Sin desires to own you. Sin desires to rule over you. There will always be another temptation. If you say, "I've got this one beat, I've conquered this one," there's another one around the corner. Another opportunity for the evil one to take hold. Another dark alleyway, you know, on and on and on. Now, we must learn to stand firm on the truth of the gospel and in the power of Jesus. We cannot give space to the devil in our lives. So my question for you today is a simple question with very difficult response. Where can you eradicate sin in your life? It's a simple question. Where can you eradicate the sin in your life? The difficulty comes with application. Are you willing to put the work in to eradicate the sin in your life? Only you can do that. God is not going to force you into that. You must do the work to begin that reconciliation process. If you don't know where to start, ask yourself questions like, "What can I confess?" I'm willing to bet within this room there's at least 80 of us that have something we can confess to God. With those who are watching online, you don't get out of this. I bet you there's something you can confess to God. And then when we confess, what can I repent of? What can I turn away from? What idols do I need to put down? What's holding me back from taking a stand against the sin in my life? If you're here this morning, you're watching online, and you have not made the ultimate decision in your life to follow God by putting your trust and faith in Jesus, now is the time. There's no way to begin that reconciliation process without Him. There's no way to begin battling sin in your life without Him. You do not have the power, the strength, or the time. You're too broken. Only God can do that. We don't put our trust and faith in Jesus to simply gain entrance into heaven. We put our trust and faith in Jesus so that He can rescue us from ourselves and change our entire lives. We put our trust and faith in Him so that we can begin to truly live. I love what N.T. Wright said. He said, the word salvation denotes rescue. Rescue? What from? Well, of course, ultimately death, and since it is sin that colludes with the forces of evil and decay, sin leads to death, so we are rescued from sin and death. It's not just this world, it's the next. God rescues us from this life into an eternal life. See, God doesn't just want you to not sin anymore. He wants to rescue you from a life that leads to an eternity where there is no hope. He wants to rescue you so that you can experience an eternity with Him at a level of joy and peace that is beyond description and understanding at the very simplest level. No matter what the world throws at you or what the devil tries to deceive you with, I want you to remember something. You have a God who hears you. The power of love behind you, the Holy Spirit within you, and all of heaven ahead of you. If you have the shepherd, you have the grace for every sin, direction for every turn, a candle for every corner, and an anchor for every storm. You have everything you need in Jesus. All you have to do is turn to Him, and He will bring you through. In a moment, we're going to end with a song of worship, as we always do, and I want you to worship God for who He is. Also for what He's done for you. Not just what He's done for you, but what He's doing for you now. And what He's going to do for you tomorrow, the day after that, and the day after that. So you would please join me in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father God, thank You for this morning. God, thank You for this opportunity that we have to come together and to worship You openly. God, we thank You for Your word where we find freedom and life. And the power to battle sin. So God, I pray that You would make everyone that hears these words, you would make them humble enough, or God, that they would humble themselves enough to ask You into their lives in a way that You would begin to point that sin out. That we would invite You in so that You can shine Your light as only You can into those sinful areas so that we can begin the process of eradicating that sin in our lives. And God, with that, I pray that You would give each person here and those who are watching online the strength to do just that. God, to invite You in and to take a stand against sin. So God, we thank You for Your Son, all the things that were done for us. God, the depth of Your love that we can't even begin to comprehend. Now we pray all this in the most powerful and precious name of Jesus. Amen.